morning, Generation Church. Stand up and let's worship the Lord together. He is so good and so faithful. We're going to worship His name this morning.
Wisdom and power. church, let's give praise unto his name, unto his name. We praise you, Jesus.
So good, so good.
Hallelujah. Magnify you, Jesus.
Great.
Decorated at 12 on Friday. So if you want to come out and help us, that will be great. So don't forget, Friday night at what time? What time?
8 o'clock.
So Friday at 8 o'clock, make sure you come out and join us. We have our communion service too, so you don't want to miss that. All right, how many of you are ready for tithes and offering? Woohoo! What a blessing it is to be able to give back to God. Lord, we just thank you, Father, for this offering, Lord. I thank you, Father, for the obedience of your people. Lord, I pray, Lord, that you bless them, that you open up the storehouses. God, that we use it to impact the city and the nation, Father, as much as we can, Father. Lord, we just thank you, God, for your many blessings, for being in the service this morning, for this baptism Sunday. Lord, bless us as we go forward. In Jesus' name, amen.
And all the earth will shout your praise, our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. All the earth will shout. shout his praise this morning. Oh, all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. Pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. Pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only. Great are you, Lord. Great are you, Lord.
Hallelujah. If you believe we serve a great God, will you just turn to somebody as you find your seat and tell them he is great. Hallelujah. Come on, tell somebody, God is good all the time. And all the time, God is good. Hallelujah. We serve a great and mighty God. And I'm glad he's in the house today. And I'm glad you're in the house today. Hallelujah. Well, this morning, today is Baptism Sunday. And we're going to be baptizing about 20 people here in just a few minutes. But hallelujah, praise God. We're excited about that. But y'all know a preacher's got to preach. So I'm going to preach a little bit because it's also Palm Sunday. And this is a big day. Amen. We're going to celebrate that Jesus is King. I got a message this morning called King Jesus. King Jesus. But before I get into the word, got something very special this morning. I want to ask Brendan and Kristen Rocha if they will come forward this morning. I want to ask my wife to come and join me. Y'all know I have a saying, the Air Force giveth and the Air Force taketh away. And these guys have been an amazing part of our church family. I can't say too much. I might get emotional. You know, I'm supposed to cry in church. It's supposed to, you know, help me preach, but I'm not going to do that today. You guys have been an amazing part of our church family, and we've grown to love you guys deeply. And they'll be heading, next Sunday will be their last Sunday with us, Easter Sunday, literally after church, they're leaving to Miami, heading to Miami. So everything's being packed up this week, and they're PCSing down to, man, Miami sounds terrible. But my wife and I, you know, we've been sad to see you guys leave, but at the same time, we're excited because I see God's hand on their life, and I know that you know, selfishly, I want to keep you guys, but you don't belong to me, you belong to him, and I see God's hand working in them, and I know that God has he's just getting started with you guys. God has got a big journey. He's put some giftings inside of you guys that are going to impact way more people than you even know. And you're going to discover that as you follow him. And I know that this move is strategic. It's instrumental in that. And will you guys just stretch your hands this way? I want to ask my wife. I'm going to ask her to pray over you guys. And I'll just stand behind you and cry a little bit.
Father, we just thank you, Lord, for the precious privilege that we've had, Lord, to be their shepherds, Lord. And I just thank you, Lord, that you are strategically moving them. God, that you're making a way for a church home, Lord. God, that you're opening up doors, Father, for a village to surround them during this time. Lord, we thank you for the promotion that you have given him. And I just thank you, Father, for opening up jobs, Lord, for her. Lord, we just thank you for going before them, Lord, for anointing them, Lord. I thank you for the destiny and the future that you have placed over their life. God, that you're going to use them mightily, Father, for your kingdom, and that your hand be upon their life, Father, and your favor be upon them. And Lord, we just thank you, Father, that you will be glorified in their life, Father. And Lord, we just thank you for your protection. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Y'all make sure you love on them this week and next. And y'all are always family. I told them yesterday, we're going to still be their weird relatives in North Carolina. Love you guys very much. But this, like my wife said, this Friday at what o'clock? Anybody remember?
8 o'clock.
The Ocho. 8 o'clock, we're going to have our Good Friday communion service right here in the sanctuary. Y'all know where it is because you're sitting here right now. 8 o'clock Friday, we're going to have our communion service. And then following, we're going to have our glow-in-the-dark Easter egg hunt, not for y'all, but for K through fifth grade outside. It's going to be fun. A bunch of kids running around in the dark. What could possibly go wrong? If you have your Bible, turn with me to John chapter 12. And while you're turning there, we are on YouTube Live today. We got our brand new, super high-tech, amazing space-age video encoder. And there was a problem with the motherboard. The flux capacitor was broken, so we sent it back, and we're looking at probably 2 months, the manufacturer said, before the new one arrives. But there's a blessing in that, because they said, well, you know, we're getting ready to release a brand new version of that that is much better than the old one, so we're going to upgrade you, and we'll give you the new release. You just got to wait a little while for it. I said, hallelujah, we'll take the upgrade. Amen. So God is good. Y'all, you can't keep a blessed man down. God works all things together for our good. Even stuff that seems to work against us, God will flip that on the enemy and work it in our favor. So we're on YouTube back in the booth, and we're on Facebook Live right now on my phone. Hey, friends. Just want to say hello to my Facebook friends. You're on my phone, so if I get any calls or text messages during church, handle it for me, okay? All right, I got my little fancy bass, my fancy TikTok bass that, oh, there, look at that, it'll follow me everywhere I go. By the way, let me just point out that I'm such a powerful influencer that as soon as I get on TikTok, the Congress passes a law to ban it. That's how influential I am. So, anyway, y'all keep your Facebook Live, y'all take care of my calls and texts while I'm preaching, all right? Amen. Okay. King Jesus. That's what we're going to talk about this morning. John 12, verse 9 says this. Great many of the Jews knew that Jesus was there, and they came not for Jesus' sake only, but they might also see Lazarus, whom he had raised from the dead. They came to see the man that Jesus called up out of the grave. Why? Because Jesus has power over death, church. We can find comfort in that today, knowing that our Savior has power over death. Not even death can stop my Jesus. He has the power over the grave. We don't have to be afraid of death because Jesus already took care of death. They came to see Lazarus too, but the chief priests plotted to put Lazarus to death. Everything God gives you, the devil wants to destroy. Mm-mm-mm. But on account of him, many of the Jews went away and believed in Jesus. They wanted to take Lazarus out because Jesus raised him from the dead. You know, people are trying to snuff out and discredit miracles today. They are trying their hardest. So-called church people are trying to convince the world that miracles don't exist, that God doesn't do miracles, but he said in his word, I am the Lord, I change not. Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And I don't know about you, but I choose to be pro-miracle myself. Hallelujah. Woe be it unto me to stand against the work of God and the Holy Spirit in the lives of men and women. The chief priest plotted to put Lazarus to death also, because on account of him, many of the Jews went away and believed on Jesus. Church, this world needs to know that we serve a miracle-working God. Verse 12, the next day a great multitude that had come to the feast, when they heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem, took branches of palm trees and went out to meet him and cried out, Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes, Baruch Hashem, Baruch Haba Hashem Adonai. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, the King of Israel. Then Jesus, when he had found a young donkey, sat on it, as it is written, Fear not, daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming, sitting on a donkey's colt. Title of my message is simply, King Jesus. Somebody say, King Jesus. Lord, thank you for your presence. God, I pray a special blessing, Lord, on those who are gathered in this room in your name today. God, I thank you that your presence is here. God, may your presence be with those who are listening online and listening by radio and listening by CD. God, I thank you. Lord, there is power in your word and life in your presence. And Lord, may your word be power and life, God, to all those who hear it this morning. In Jesus' name. Today is Palm Sunday. This morning we commemorate the triumphant entry of Jesus into Jerusalem. As Jesus entered this holy city, they were waving palm branches and placing them in his path as he entered the city gates. Palm Sunday is recorded in all four Gospels, Matthew 21, Mark 11, Luke 19, and here in John 12. And this is a hugely significant events. You see, Palm Sunday set in motion the events that would lead up to the crucifixion of Jesus. When Jesus came marching into the city, the crowds were on fire. They were excited. They were enthusiastic because they thought that Jesus was going to bring them political victory. But the minute they found out that Jesus was not going to be their political savior, they turned on him. Because Jesus did not come to bring political victory. Jesus did not come to set the Jewish people free from Roman power. Jesus came to break the ultimate power that not only bound the Jewish people, but has bound every man and every woman from the fall of mankind. He came to break the power of sin and death. Jesus is not a political savior. He is a spiritual savior. He doesn't come to set political captives free. He comes to bring people who are dead to spiritual life. Jesus entered the city of Jerusalem on this day, not to visit the city, not just to celebrate a feast. He entered into that city because he was on his way to offer himself as the sacrifice for our sins. This is an important day to remember, and I pray that its meaning would sink into your heart today, because on Palm Sunday, Jesus announced, I am King. Zechariah prophesied of that day, behold, your king is coming. This is one of the most prophetic events that ever happened in the history of the world. You know, the prophet Daniel in ancient times spoke about this day. He prophesied that from the day the decree goes forth to rebuild Jerusalem, the countdown begins, and in exactly 173,800 days from that decree, the Messiah would enter the holy city. We talked about this in our study on Revelation. 95 years went by, and Daniel was dead and buried in a tomb. 95 years after that prophecy, the king of Persia gave the decree, and exactly 173,880 days go by. And on March 30th, 33 AD, Jesus the Messiah, on the very day, shows up and enters in procession in the city of Jerusalem. You can't convince me that Jesus is not the truth. That proves to me, beyond a shadow of a doubt, from the Jewish scriptures, that Jesus Christ is the way. He is the Messiah. He is the one. He showed up on the day the ancient prophets said he would. And when Jesus rode into Jerusalem, he announced, "I am the king." And Jesus is no ordinary king. There's nobody like Jesus. He is the undeniable, indisputable, all-sufficient, everlasting, unchangeable, unshakable, ever-living, eternal King. All authority in heaven and earth has been given to him. And when Jesus is king of your life, something happens. In fact, I'm going to give you three things that happen when you make Jesus your king. Number one, Jesus brings peace. Jesus brings peace. Tell somebody, Jesus brings peace. John 12, 14 says this, "Then Jesus, when he had found a young donkey, sat on it, as it is written, 'Fear not, daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming, sitting on a donkey's colt.'" You know, when I was a child, I wondered, why did it have to be a donkey? Why did it have, you know, I grew up out in the woods. I grew up in Red Oak. And our neighbor had a donkey, and I hated that old donkey. Waking me up in the morning. Why did Jesus have to ride on a donkey? In my mind, I wanted Jesus to come storming in on a stallion. You know what I mean? In fact, in the book of Revelation, the Bible tells us that one day soon, Jesus will descend from heaven riding on a white horse. A kingly horse. Air Horse One. You know what I'm saying? But on that day in Jerusalem, he was riding on a lowly donkey. But that's important. That's significant. Because in war, kings would ride horses into battle, but a donkey was only used in times of peace. If you saw a king riding on a donkey, that means that this king comes not to bring war, but to bring peace. Let me tell you something. Real peace only comes from Jesus. You cannot have true peace in your heart and true peace in your mind apart from the Lord Jesus Christ. He is the Prince of Peace. 1 Peter 5, 7 says, "Casting all your care upon him, for he cares for you." Colossians 3, 15. I love this verse. I stand on this verse in difficult times of life. "Let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to which you were also called in one body, and be thankful." Philippians 4, 6 says, "Be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God." And listen to this, "The peace of God, which surpasses all understanding." It don't even make sense. You cannot comprehend it. You cannot explain it. But the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds. How? Through Christ Jesus. Because he is the Prince of Peace. He is the King who brings peace. Prince of Peace in the Hebrew language is Sar Shalom. Come on, y'all just humor me. Say Sar Shalom. Look at that. Y'all, some Hebrew talkers in the house today. That word shalom is the word that the Jewish people would use to greet one another in those days. So y'all just humor me again. Come on, look at your neighbor and say shalom. Now come on, look at somebody else and say shalom. See, you're hanging with your shalomies today. they would say shalom. It was their greeting to one another. It's the same root as the Arabic word salam. In the Arab-speaking world, people would greet one another, assalamu alaikum, peace be unto you. And they would reply, assalamu or alaikum salam, right? Which means unto you peace. So shalom, like salam, means peace, but the Hebrew meaning is a deep meaning. It literally means nothing broken and nothing missing. Come on, say that. Nothing broken, nothing missing. So when the Bible promises us peace through Christ Jesus, it's promising not that he will make everything easy, not that he will make all of your wildest dreams come true. Vote for Pedro. Here's what the Bible promises about Jesus. He will heal the brokenness in your life, and he will fill everything that's missing in your heart. When you have the peace of God through Jesus Christ, you might be falling apart on the outside, but you can have peace on the inside. Because he is the Prince of Peace. Nothing broken, nothing missing. Listen to the word of God in Isaiah 9:6. It says of Jesus, his name will be called Wonderful Counselor. Y'all don't believe in counseling? You might not like Jesus because he's a wonderful counselor. Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace, there is no limit to his peace. There will be no end. But notice those two words are together, government and peace. Government and peace. When I think about government, I don't think peace. I mean, I've been rebuking the IRS in Jesus' name. Y'all stay away from me. But it says of Jesus that his government and his peace, they're linked together. That means that if you want his peace, you've got to come under his government. That's talking about the lordship of Jesus. If you want the peace that he offers, he's got to be your king. Jesus is not an official that we elect and vote out of office. He is king supreme, and we come under his lordship. You're with me so far? Amen. Jesus is the Prince of Peace. And if you want peace, you've got to answer this question: who's on the throne of your life? Because if you put anybody else on the throne, you'll never have that kind of peace. And so many times we're tempted to put somebody other than Jesus. And most of the time, we put ourselves. Jesus prayed to the Father, not my will be done. But so many times in our minds we say, not thy will be done, but my will be done. Let my kingdom come. It's all about what I want and all about what I feel. But church, you'll never be happy. Right. Not really. You might have fun for a little while. I mean, I could go out to the parking lot right now and steal any of y'all's car. And I could have a lot of fun for about 2 hours. But I ain't going to have peace tonight when I get caught. I mean, I could steal your car and go rob Krispy Kreme. I mean, I'll leave the cash, but I'll take the donuts. And I could just have a good old time for a while. But in the end, I won't have any peace. Come on. Are y'all with me? You tracking me? Some of y'all are making sure you got your keys. The Bible calls that the passing pleasure of sin. Sin is fun for a while. Baby, it's fun. Feels good. But in the end, it leads to death and pain and heartache and destruction. Sin will ruin your life and destroy your soul. Amen. For what? An eternity away from God. A life devoid of peace. Who's on the throne of your life? If it's anybody but Jesus, it's time for a regime change, church. I don't know about you, but I want that peace of God that passes all understanding. I want Jesus on the throne. Amen. Where was I? I'm not even on my notes, but that was for somebody. Jesus is the Prince of Peace. His peace and his government go together. If you need peace, it's easy. Make Jesus Lord. Yes. Die to yourself. Yes. Make him king. Yes. Hallelujah. When Jesus is your king, number one, Jesus brings peace. Number two, Jesus brings victory. In ancient Christianity, palm branches symbolized victory, church. With palm branches, they celebrated the victory that Jesus gave us over sin and death through his sacrifice on the cross. That's why in ancient times, you would see palm branches on coins and on important buildings and palaces. In fact, King Solomon had palm branches carved into the walls and the doors of the temple in Jerusalem. 1 Kings chapter 6, on the walls all around the temple, in both the inner and the outer rooms, he carved cherubim and palm trees and flowers. Why palm branches? Because Jesus comes in victory. Jesus said in John 16, 33, in the world you will have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. I'm teaching my son at an early age because kids wrestle with fear and anxiety. That blows my mind, y'all. The kids are growing up in a different world than we grew up in. My parents would let me outside in the morning and lock the door and say, don't come back till the sun goes down. They didn't know where I was, and they didn't care. And I didn't get kidnapped. I didn't run off a cliff. I didn't die. Some of you are like, well, did you die? No, I'm right here. I mean, we would do stupid stuff. Me and my brother, we would do stupid stuff all day long. Play with snakes and make sharp spears and chase each other. We would do dumb stuff. And we didn't worry about anything. But kids today, because they live in a connected world, they live in a media-saturated world. They're constantly bombarded with information. Kids today, little kids, worry about everything. Y'all, there are kids in our community that are committing suicide at 8 and 9 and 10 years old. My God, that is not the world that I grew up in. We are living in a toxic culture, a culture dominated by fear, dominated by anxiety. So I'm teaching my son at the age of 9 that Jesus brings us victory. Every night when we pray, I've started this recently. I've started saying, Jesus, I thank you that we have victory over fear. That we have victory over the world. I thank you that we are overcomers through you. That you have defeated the devil. You have defeated the world. You have defeated fear. You have defeated anxiety. You have not given us a spirit of fear, but of power, love, and a sound mind. I'm trying to teach him at a young age that Jesus brings us victory. But church, do you know that Jesus brings you victory? Because I learned, and it took me a few years to kind of catch on, because, you know, we can put ourselves in a little church bubble where we think everybody believes what we believe. Oh, no, baby. I learned that Goldsboro is a very religious area, and religious people take a lot of pride, spiritual pride, in being defeated. Oh, I'm just a sinner saved by grace. Ain't nothing, don't deserve nothing, never going to be nothing. And there's a whole lot of church people that have the mindset of, I just want to barely scrape it into heaven. Amen. That I just want a little shack on the edge of heaven overlooking a lake view of the lake of fire. Like, I just want to barely make it into heaven, living life completely defeated, when you need to know that your Jesus died on the cross to overcome all the power of hell, all the power of sin, and he overcome and defeated all the spirits of this world. Jesus overcame the world. But he didn't just stop there. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law, but thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Do you understand that Jesus took the keys to death, hell, and the grave, and he led captivity captive? Death could not stop him. Nothing can hold Jesus back. All the forces of hell can't withstand him. And not even death can separate us from his love. Church, you have victory in Jesus. I dare you to make your neighbor uncomfortable and just tell them, I have victory in Jesus. Oh, three of you did it. Thank you. Come on, tell somebody, I got victory in Jesus. Church, we got victory over sin. We got victory over sickness. We got victory over fear. We got victory over depression. Revelation 7:9, after this I looked, and there before me was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, tribe, people, and language, standing before the throne and before the Lamb. They were wearing white robes and were holding palm branches in their hands. What started on Palm Sunday will continue into eternity. When we get into heaven, it is a celebration of the victory that we have in Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. Church, every Sunday is Palm Sunday in heaven. Heaven and earth will pass away, but the word of the Lord is everlasting. We're going to be singing victory forever with Jesus. When Jesus is king, he brings peace. Number two, he brings victory. Number three, when Jesus is king, his people praise him. The 22nd Psalm tells us that God inhabits the praises of his people. Jesus said in Matthew 18:20, where two or three are gathered in my name, I am there in the midst of them. I can't explain it, but I believe it because Jesus said it. That when we gather in the name of Jesus, he shows up in this place. Wherever you are, you could be in Walmart. You find another believer, you gather in the name of Jesus, he'll show up right there. You gather in the workplace. I don't know about y'all, but I've worked in some hellish workplaces, and the Generation Church is not one of them. I've worked out in the world, man. I've worked in some rough spots with some rough people, and my Holy Ghost radar was always on the look for another believer, somebody I could just stand and agree with in the name of Jesus. We need some Holy Ghost up in this place. Hallelujah. Where two or three are gathered in my name, I am there in the midst of them. And if I can't find somebody else, I'll just do Jesus all by myself. Hallelujah. Amen. Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead dwells inside of me. I'll unleash the Holy Ghost on you. All right. Jesus shows up when we gather in his name. He is here. Bible says that on Palm Sunday, as he entered the holy city, that the people began to shout his praise. When he came near the place where the road goes down to the Mount of Olives, the whole crowd of disciples began to joyfully praise God in loud voices for all the miracles they had seen. They shouted, blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord, peace in heaven and glory in the highest. But then the haters came on the scene, didn't they? Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to Jesus, teacher, rebuke your disciples. There is always a voice trying to silence your praise. Always. Listen to what Jesus said. I tell you, if they keep quiet, the stones will cry out. I don't know about you, but I refuse to let a dumb rock outpraise me. Because Jesus didn't shed his blood for a rock, he shed his blood for me. He didn't die on the cross for a rock, he died on the cross for me. So church, for a moment before we continue, can we just stand and praise the King of Kings on this Palm Sunday? Can we just lift our palms to the Savior this morning and just lift up some praise to Jesus? Lord, we bless you. Jesus, you are the King of Kings and you are the Lord of Lords. And right now, in the name of Jesus, Lord, we just praise you and exalt you and we magnify you in this place. Jesus, we thank you that you are King, that you are Lord, and we thank you that we have victory
In Jesus, Lord, we celebrate the victory we have. Lord, you defeated death. You defeated hell. You defeated the grave. Lord, you broke the power of sin. And Lord, we praise you. And we celebrate that this morning. In the mighty name of Jesus, will you remain standing just a moment as you musicians come. And as we get ready for baptisms in just a moment, I just want to ask you this question. Is Jesus your King? Is he the Lord of your life? Have you received him as your King this morning? Many, many people cheered for Jesus on that day in Jerusalem, but the Bible says that only those who receive him as Lord will be saved. John 1:12 says, as many as received him, to them he gave power to become children of God, to them that believe on his name. So on Palm Sunday, as we focus on the entry of Jesus into Jerusalem, let me ask you, as he entered the gates of your city, has Jesus entered your heart today? Because he can bring so much change to your life this morning. Jesus can change everything if you'll invite him to be the Lord of your life, to be your Savior this morning. Through every trial, every heartache, through every season of life, Jesus said, I'll be with you always to the end of the age. Those sins that have bound you up, Jesus can break that off of you in a moment, like nobody else, because he is great and he is strong, and he defeated death, hell, and the grave. I want to lead you just in a simple prayer this morning. Will you just join me in prayer, and let's pray this out loud. Jesus, forgive me of my sins. Come into my heart. Be my King. Be the Lord of my life. And Jesus, with your help, with your strength, I'll follow you. I'll live for you. I'll serve you the rest of my life. In Jesus' name, amen. Hallelujah. Father, I pray, God, for every person here this morning, Lord, who's made the decision to follow you, whether it's right now in this moment, God, or they've been walking with you for a long time. God, I just pray for strength and encouragement this morning to know, Lord, that you are with them. God, through every season, through every trial, through every heartache, through every pain, God, I thank you that you are still Lord, that you are still the Prince of Peace. You're still the one, God, who heals the brokenness, God, who fills every void. And God, I pray, Lord, for those who are in need this morning, God, that they would feel your presence in this place today. God, I thank you for your strength. I thank you for your life. I thank you, Lord, for your love, for your power. God, for your presence in this place today. Thank you, Lord, for being our strength. Thank you, Lord, for the victory that we have in you. God, I thank you, Lord, that the enemy is defeated. I thank you, Lord, that the power of sin is broken. And Lord, I thank you that we have new life in you. In the mighty name of Jesus. Hallelujah. I want to ask everybody who wants to be baptized this morning, if you'll line up along this wall to your left, on the left wall of the auditorium, as we get ready this morning. This is a special day, church. People are going public with their faith in Jesus. Hallelujah. Baptism is a beautiful symbol of new life in Christ. Jesus said in Matthew 28, to go into all the world and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Baptism is a powerful symbol. When you go under the water, it symbolizes that your old life is gone. When you come up out of the water, it symbolizes being raised to new life in Christ Jesus. You may be seated for a moment so everybody can get a good look. Is my Facebook crowd still with me? Oh, my phone has followed somebody else. What are you doing, phone? You have followers that I know not of. Yep. Hey, everybody. My phone has gone rogue. The robots have finally rebelled. There we go. Let's move this back a little bit so you guys watching online can see our baptisms. All right. And if you want to be baptized and you're watching online, go ahead and get in your car now. We'll wait for you. All right. I'm going to hand the microphone over to my... Well, she's got her own microphone. All right. And as everybody, as they come out of the water, will you guys do something? Will you just cheer loud and celebrate and encourage them as they go public with their faith today? And I think it'll be all right if we could turn the heat up just a little bit in here, since everybody's going to be soaking wet. You never hear me turn the heat up. But I do it because I love you. let's stand and just praise God this morning. Let's thank God for every life change. Let's thank God. We're going public with this thing today. Lord, we praise you. You are the God, Lord, who takes us from death to life. You break the power of sin. You give us a hope in the future. And Lord, we celebrate this morning. And we praise you, God, for everything you've done, everything you're doing. Come on, if you got a testimony, just praise big this morning. Thank you for your goodness. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for your faithfulness. Thank you for your redeeming power. Thank you for your redeeming love. Thank you for your cleansing blood. Thank you for the power of the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. We praise you, Jesus. We magnify you. We lift you up. We exalt you in this place. You are worthy. You deserve the glory. You deserve the honor. You deserve the power. You deserve the praise. You're worthy of it all, Jesus. You're worthy of it all, Jesus. You're worthy, oh God. Glory and honor, dominion, majesty, power, and praise. Hallelujah. Glory to God. May God bless you and your household. And may you be a blessing to everybody you encounter this week. Because God has put you where you are to shine the light of Jesus, to be a blessing. You are God's ambassador. Remember that this week. In your house, in your neighborhood, in your workplace, God has strategically placed you where you are to shine the light of Jesus bright. So shine, baby, shine. Let the light and the glory of Jesus shine bright in you this week. And let's change this world for Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah. Glory, 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 glory. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. I want to ask our prayer team to come. If you need prayer for any reason, we got some men and women of God who want to pray for you. If you gave your life to Jesus today and you want to get baptized, oh, the water's warm. I'll hang around. I'll dunk you in the name of Jesus. Amen. We'll give you a GC t-shirt you can wear home. Hallelujah. What a wonderful day. I can't think of a better way to honor King Jesus than to baptize people in his name. Amen. Church, I hope you have a wonderful week. Go in the favor of God. Walk in victory this week. Even in the face of defeat, we have victory, church. We have victory. God works all things together for good to them that love God, who are called according to his purpose. Never lose sight of that. Don't you forget it. Our God is a God of victory who always causes us to triumph. We can't win for losing. We can't lose for winning. We can't win for losing. Can't lose for winning. We are overcomers. Y'all know what I mean. Have a great week, guys. We'll see you Wednesday night for Bible study and Friday at 8 o'clock for communion.